Welcome to our Pharma Topics channel, which aims at simplifying the pharmacy subjects and allied health sciences subjects, and to help the GPAT preparation students to understand the concepts and make it easy for them to attend the competitive exams at national level and as well as the state level. Today, our topic of discussion is hypertension. Before entering into this unit, let us see the pathology of hypertension. There are four kinds of hypertension. One is normal pressure, where the systole is less than 120 mm of mercury and diastole is less than 80 mm of mercury. Pre-hypertension, systole falls between 120 to 129, diastole falls between 80 to 89. Stage 1 hypertension, the systole increases to 140 to 159, diastole increases to 90 to 99, and stage 2 hypertension, where the systole is greater than 160 and diastole is greater than 100. The blood pressure is a mix of cardiac output and the total peripheral vascular resistance. The factors contributing to hypertension are the sympathetic discharge or the sympathetic outflow, renin angiotensin system, and the interaction between the sympathetic discharge and the renin angiotensin aldosterone system called mosaic theory, and then the altered vascular resistance, that is the vascular changes which are happening due to the hypertension. There are two kinds of hypertension. One is primary hypertension, where there is no identifiable cause, and the next one is secondary hypertension. It is due to renal disease or adrenal hyperfunction. They are of primary hyperaldosteronism or pheochromocytoma, that is the tumor of adrenal gland, or renal artery stenosis. The complications of hypertension include several multiple effects, such as cardiac effects causing left ventricular hypertrophy, which leads to cardiac remodeling, myocardial infarction, angina, and congestive cardiac failure. Then renal effects include nephrosclerosis and renal failure. Then cerebral effects include cerebral ischemia, thrombosis, aneurysms, and with hemorrhage. And the retinal effects include retinal vascular sclerosis and visual defects. So let us see the classification of antihypertensives. They act at four different levels. One may be at the kidneys, one at the heart, one at the blood vessels, one at the brain, and one at the aldosterone or the adrenal glands. So the first line diuretics are, first line drugs are the diuretics. They are thiazides and loop diuretics. They decrease the sodium excretion and they decrease the blood volume, and thus they act as antihypertensives. And the next is potassium sparing diuretics or aldosterone antagonists, such as spironolactone and eplerenone, and these are weak diuretics. The next is renin inhibitors, enalkarin and remicarin. Then angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors such as captopril, enalapril and all the prils. Then angiotensin receptor blockers such as losartan, valsartan, irbesartan and all the sartans. The next is beta blockers. They act at two levels, one at the heart and one at the vascular system. All the OL drugs are beta blockers. The next is alpha blockers, which act at the blood vessels, prazosin, tarazosin, alfuzosin, and other vasodilators are calcium channel blockers, hydralazine, minoxidil and phenyldopan. Losartan is additionally having vasodilatory properties, which is basically an angiotensin receptor blocker, and drugs which reduce the central sympathetic discharge are alpha 2 agonists such as clonidine, moxiclonidine and methyldopa, ganglionic blockers such as trimethoprim, and adrenergic neuron blockers such as beryllium and reserpine. So let us see the diuretics first. Already a diuretics video has been posted for your reference, which you can go through the entire set of diuretics. The most important diuretics used as antihypertensives are thiazide diuretics. They block the increase in the sodium and water retention. They cause excretion of sodium and water, and short term effects are decreased blood volume and decreased cardiac output, and thus they decrease the blood pressure. And the long term effects are decreasing the sodium content of blood vessels. They decrease the sensitivity of the blood vessels to the vasopressors such as adrenaline and noradrenaline, and thus chronically they reduce the peripheral vascular resistance, and put together they decrease the blood pressure. So the thiazides are the first choice antihypertensives. They are hydrochlorothiazide, chlorothiazide, indapamide and metolazone. The adverse effects of thiazides are hypokalemia, hyperuricemia, hypertriglyceridemia, hyperglycemia and hypercalcemia. All the drugs are sulfa drugs, so they may cause sulfa allergy, and they may cause electrolyte disturbances. Drug interactions are with NSAIDs, which may reduce the efficacy of thiazides when they are combined together. The next is loop diuretics. They are called high ceiling diuretics. They are furosemide, torosemide, bumetanide and ethacrynic acid. They cause brisk intense diuresis, but they have shorter duration of action. The adverse effects are very similar to thiazides, but they cause hypocalcemia because loop loses the calcium, and other adverse effects are very similar to thiazides. Apart from this, because of their brisk diuresis, they lead to hypovolemia, and transient deafness may occur because the loop diuretics they distribute in the vestibular system. The drug interactions are very similar to thiazides, that is NSAIDs reduce the efficacy of loop diuretics. And aminoglycosides, when they are combined with loop diuretics, they increase the risk of transient deafness. The next is potassium sparing diuretics. They are used only as adjuncts to thiazides or loop diuretics. Spironolactone, eplerenone, amiloride and triamterene. The adverse effects are hyperkalemia. The drug interactions include when they are combined with ACE inhibitors, they increase the risk of hyperkalemia. The next most important category of drugs are the drugs decreasing the action of renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system. So let us understand what is this RAS. When the renal blood flow is reduced, the liver produces or releases a protein called angiotensinogen. This angiotensinogen is converted by the renin, which is released by the kidneys, to angiotensin 1. This angiotensin 1 is converted to angiotensin 2 by the enzyme called angiotensin converting enzyme, which is released from the lungs. This angiotensin converting enzyme is a very important enzyme which also metabolizes bradykinin, which is autokinin. And the angiotensin 2 is a most important contributor in this RAS system. It has multiple effects. And the blood vessels, it causes direct vasoconstriction. In the brain, it increases the sympathetic discharge, which leads to rapid pressure response. From the kidneys, they release aldosterone, that increases the sodium and water retention in the distal convoluted tubules, and thus the blood volume is increased. That leads to a slow pressor response or slow increase in the blood pressure. And the next is angiotensin 2 directly acts on the heart. It increases the sympathetic discharge. So the cardiotonic activities like heart rate, cardiovascular remodeling are all increased. It increases the chances of left ventricular hypertrophy. It increases preload and afterload. So it leads to cardiac abnormalities like congestive cardiac failure on long run. And apart from this, angiotensin 2 also increases the release of angiotensinogen from the liver. So the drugs addressing these the RAS system are direct renin inhibitors, then angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors and angiotensin receptor blockers. So let us see the angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors. They are used in hypertension, congestive heart failure, myocardial infarction, diabetic nephropathy, diabetic neuropathy and scleroderma crisis. So you remember the ACE inhibitors with a code. All the drugs they complete with PRIL. So captopril, lisinopril, fosinopril, enalapril, trandalopril, benazepril, perindopril and moxipril are all belonging to the ACE inhibitors. So you remember just the code captopril. The prils cause cough. They increase the bradykinin levels by inhibiting the enzyme ACE. So it may cause dry cough. The next one is it causes angioedema because of the increase of bradykinin. All the ACE inhibitors are prodrugs, but except captopril and lisinopril, they may cause taste disturbances, which is called dysgeusia. They may cause orthostatic hypotension when combined with the diuretics. All these drugs are contraindicated in pregnancy, and they are contraindicated in bilateral renal artery stenosis. They increase the risk of hyperkalemia or increased potassium levels in the blood, and they lower the formation of angiotensin II, which is their mechanism. Enalaprilat is a metabolite of enalapril. It is also having ACE inhibitory activity. So let us see what is a bilateral renal artery stenosis. In case of renal artery stenosis, the renal perfusion is maintained only by angiotensin II. So when the ACE inhibitors block this enzyme, then you block this angiotensin II formation, then the renal perfusion is reduced, which leads to renal failure. So that is why they are contraindicated. Both the ARBs and ACE inhibitors are contraindicated in the renal artery, bilateral renal artery stenosis. The next category of drugs is angiotensin receptor blockers. They are used similar to ACE inhibitors. All the drugs, they finish with the code sartans: losartan, valsartan, telmisartan, irbesartan, candesartan and iprosartan. They act at the angiotensin 1 receptors, but they don't cause dry cough or angioedema similar to like the ACE inhibitors. The special features of losartan are they produce active metabolite, antiplatelet action. It is also having antiplatelet action, causing antagonism of thromboxane A2. It has a mild uricosuric effect. The special features of telmisartan are additional PPAR gamma agonist activity, which is useful in diabetic cases. The direct renin inhibitors are aliskirin and enalkirin. They are used only in combination with ACE inhibitors, ARBs, beta blockers and diuretics. The next category, major category, is sympatholytics or the beta blockers. The beta blockers have multiple effects. They act at the heart, reduce the heart rate or the cardiac output. They act at the kidneys. They block the beta 1 receptors present in the kidneys, which reduces the renin output. So which consequently reduces the formation of angiotensin 1 and angiotensin 2. So the renin angiotensin aldosterone system is blocked. So all these put together, they reduce the blood pressure. The classification of the beta blockers, they may be non-selective like propranolol. They may be selective like pindolol or celiprolol. They are beta blockers with a beta 2 partial activity on the skeletal muscle blood vessels, which causes vasodilation and reduced peripheral vascular resistance. So they are the antihypertensive drugs suitable for patients with bradycardia because the total peripheral vascular resistance is reduced. The next drugs are mixed alpha and beta blockers such as carvedilol and labetalol. They are antihypertensive drugs suitable for pheochromocytoma. The next category are carvedilol additionally has nitric oxide releasing activity. It decreases the peripheral vascular resistance, and they are the antihypertensives suitable for congestive heart failure patients. So the beta blockers are suitable for patients with tachycardia associated with atrial fibrillation, paroxysmal supraventricular tachycardia, post myocardial infarction, coronary artery disease and diabetes mellitus. The adverse effects are bradyarrhythmias, so ECG has to be checked regularly. All the beta blockers are not safe in asthma, and they may cause bradyarrhythmias. they are not suitable for diabetes mellitus, Raynaud's syndrome, which causes the blackening of the tips of fingers because the smaller capillary blood vessels are blocked by the beta 2 blocking activity of the beta blockers. They may cause neurological symptoms like fatigue, lethargy, and they may worsen the depression. The most important point to get remembered in beta blockers, the withdrawal syndrome. Abrupt withdrawal may increase the anginal pain, myocardial infarction, and life-threatening rebound hypertension. So let us see the sympatholytics, the alpha blockers. They act at the alpha 1 receptors present in the blood vessels. The alpha blockers are the second choice antihypertensives next to the diuretics. They are prazosin, tarazosin, alfuzosin, tamsulosin, and silodosin. Particularly, tamsulosin and silodosin are used for benign prostate hyperplasia. The alpha blockers, they don't disturb the lipid levels, which is with the beta blockers or the diuretics. They are safe in coronary artery disease, safe in patients with hyperuricemia or gout. They dilate both the arteries and veins, but the reflex tachycardia is very less when compared to the direct vasodilators like hydralazine. The adverse effects is most prominent is first dose hypotension. So the dose may be administered at bedtime with a lower dose as the starting dose. The other adverse effects are diarrhea, weight gain, dry mouth, urinary urgency, constipation, and priapism. Particularly, tamsulosin and silodosin may cause floppy iris syndrome. Let us see the drugs decreasing the central sympathetic outflow. So there is in the brain there is a portion called nucleus of tractus solitarius where the alpha 2 receptors are present. It is having a dual action connectivity with the vagal nucleus and rostral ventrolateral medulla. When the alpha 2 agonists act on them, the direct agonists such as clonidine and moxonidine act on the directly on the nucleus of tractus solaris, it reduces the vagal tone, so there is no reflex tachycardia. It acts at the rostral ventral medulla, ventrolateral medulla, which decreases the sympathetic outflow, which put together decreases the blood pressure. The alpha methyl dopa is also very similar in action, but it is a false neurotransmitter, acts as a substrate and produces alpha methyl noradrenaline, which acts as a alpha 2 agonist. So put together, they decrease the total central sympathetic outflow, which leads to their decrease in the blood pressure. So methyl dopa has a little effect on cardiac effect and heart rate, but methyl dopa is safe in pregnancy. The adverse effects are orthostatic hypotension, rebound hypotension on abrupt withdrawal. Hepatic dysfunction may occur, which has to be followed for nearly 6 months of therapy with methyldopa. Apart from this, the most important adverse effect is hemolytic anemia. So the patients has to check the positivity for Coombs test. Clonidine is very similar to methyldopa. It is effective in patients with renal impairment. The abrupt withdrawal leads to rebound hypertension. Apart from this, it causes sedation, dry mouth, and it may worsen the depression. The adrenergic neuron blockers, they deplete the catecholamines in the adrenergic neurons. They are reserpine, beryllium, guanidine. They are used only in the refractory hypertension where no other drugs are available or working. The adverse effects are severe depression leading to suicidal tendencies, postural hypotension even if used for longer period. In contrast to the alpha blockers, the postural hypotension reduces, attenuates on prolonged use, whereas postural hypotension in this case occurs even if they are used for longer period. The other adverse effects are severe depression leading to suicidal tendencies, postural hypotension even if used for longer period. Then the ganglionic blockers such as trimethoprim used with nitroprusside as a slow IV infusion in hypertensive emergencies, particularly in dissection of aorta. The next category is vasodilators. they act directly on the blood vessels. They are of three kinds. One is potassium channel openers, nitric oxide releasers, and calcium channel blockers. All these things, they lead to vasodilation and they decrease the blood pressure. The vasodilators are the second line drugs in patients refractory to initial therapy with diuretics, ACE inhibitors, ARBs, beta blockers, or calcium channel blockers. They directly relax the arteries and veins, or both. The calcium channel blockers are alternatives to the beta blockers, which are contraindicated in patients such as with those with coronary artery disease, bronchial asthma, or Raynaud's disease. The calcium channel blockers block the L-type calcium channels in the blood vessels and the heart. They are now preferred for or the drug of choice for hypertensive emergencies such as clavidipine. Previously, nitroprusside is used in emergency cases. Nowadays, it is not preferred. The dihydropyridines calcium channel blockers, they finish with the dipines. They act on the blood vessels. Amlodipine, nifedipine, felodipine, isradipine, nimodipine, and clavidipine. There are another category of drugs called phenyl alkyl amines, verapamil and diltiazem, directly act on the heart and not on the blood vessels. The adverse effects of calcium channel blockers are reflex tachycardia with the dipines and cardiodepressant activity with the phenyl alkyl amines. The next is hydralazine. It is an arteriodilator used intravenously or intramuscularly to manage hypertensive crisis. It acts by opening the potassium channels in the blood vessels, and additionally it releases nitric oxide. Reflex tachycardia is more common. It may induce angina in patients with coronary artery disease. So it should be combined with the beta blockers to minimize this adverse effect. Apart from this, hydralazine is metabolized by acetylation, and it may cause drug-induced systemic lupus erythematosus. So the patients who are slow acetylators are more prone for this adverse effect. The next drug is minoxidil. It is a potent arteriodilator than hydralazine to manage. It is used to manage severe hypertension refractory to conventional drug regimens. It preserves the renal blood flow. It is a potassium channel opener. It causes a reflex tachycardia and fluid retention, which can be reduced by combination with diuretics. The most important adverse effect of minoxidil is hypertrichosis, which occurs when it is used for more than 4 weeks. Topically, minoxidil is available for growth of hair in the bald head. The next drug is sodium nitroprusside. It is an arterio and venodilator, that is, both arteries and veins are dilated. It is a nitric oxide releaser by stimulating the cyclic guanosyl monophosphate in the blood vessels. It is used only for short-term emergency treatment of hypertension when a rapid action is required. The half-life of the drug is just 1 to 2 minutes. It requires careful blood pressure monitoring because hypotension may occur immediately. And the solution has to be protected from light. It is light sensitive. On chronic use, it may lead to cyanide toxicity. The next drug is phenyldapam. It is a dopamine antagonist, D1 antagonist, used only for short-term control of blood pressure in hypertensive emergencies, particularly in patients with renal dysfunction. I hope I have given a nutshell of the antihypertensives. Happy learning. Thank you for listening. Kindly subscribe to our Pharma Topics channel to put more videos and encourage us in doing this work. Thank you.